Hi, Martin here. It's early April here in Muskoka, Ontario, and we're just taking a walk today in this nice hardwood forest in search of early spring wild edibles. Early April is really a great time to start looking for spring wild edibles because the snow is gone, and as you can see, there's a lot of leaf litter on the ground still, and very little vegetation has sprung up yet. And what does spring up is actually very easy to identify at this time of year because you won't be overwhelmed by an overabundance of plants. Let's see what we can find.
Hi. So we found our first plant, and it's spring beauty. Come and take a look at it.
It's a very delicate little flower. The first spring bloom you'll see in this region. And it's got five petals, and the petals are either white or lightly pink, and it's got purple or pink veins on the petals. It has an incredibly weak stem that's being entirely supported by the leaf litter around it. If you remove the leaf litter, the plant just falls to the ground. There. The entire plant is edible. You can eat the stem, the leaves, the flower, and at the base of it is a corm. The corm can range in size from the size of a lentil, that's very small, to the size of an acorn or chestnut. They can actually get decent sized. It all has a similar taste. The taste of it is mild, with a very slightly peppery aftertaste. It's very good. I really like it. One of the things we're doing today in the foods that we're going to find and show you are all plants that taste good at this time of year. We're not trying to show survival foods, foods that you'd only eat in a pinch when you're starving to death in the woods. We're interested in wild edibles for eating them, and we look for the ones that taste good. And we try everything, and sometimes we find things that we don't like the taste of and we don't go back to them. But these are all ones we've tried before, and they all taste good, the ones we're going to show you today. So let's dig these up. I take a few things with me when I go digging for wild edibles. I always bring a pair of gloves, a digging tool. You can use a stick if you don't have one of these. And a bunch of bags. I like to keep the different edibles that we collect separate so that I can make sure that I have the right vegetables before I put them in my food. I like to take a second look at them. And I always bring field guides. These videos and videos like this one are great for seeing the plants and getting an idea of what's out there and what's good to eat, but you should never go out into the bush and put something in your mouth just based on what you see in these. If you're going to look for wild edibles, get books especially dedicated to wild edible plants, and make sure you have the plant identification right before you put anything in your mouth. Another thing I should mention is if you do this, the first time you try a new plant, I recommend not doing it on a camping trip. It's really great to have wild edibles when you're on a camping trip, but if you're going to try a plant for the first time, try to do it when you're near civilization, just in case you've made a mistake. Because, and I can speak from experience, even when you're really sure the first time that you've got the right plant identified, there's always an element of uncertainty in your mind. You can't be really 100% sure. So make sure that it tastes the way it's supposed to taste, and just be safe about it. Always try a small amount first. And then wait a day before filling up a plate with it. Anyways, let's dig this baby up and see what the corm looks like. The spring beauty plant is so delicate that you have to be really careful when you're trying to get it out. Usually the corms are very close to the surface. This one unfortunately isn't, and I'm worried about breaking it. Sometimes they're so close to the surface that you really don't have to dig at all. They're just underneath the leaf litter. I'm hoping this is close. They have a tendency to break kind of easily too. But oh, like this one. I think, did I break it? Got it. Good size one too. There. Okay. So this one is actually a decent size for a spring beauty corm. It's, I don't know, the size of a kidney bean or something. And it has a skin on it. It's dirty right now. I'm not going to eat this one. But the skin comes off, and you can eat it without the skin. Or you can just wash it and eat it with the skin. The skin doesn't have a strong taste at all. The whole thing is a very mild-tasting little vegetable. So here's the plant, and it's pretty clean because it was growing on top of the leaf litter, and I'm going to eat it right now. They're really good. They're really mild. I mean, it tastes like a bean sprout is what it tastes like, probably because it isn't much different than one, really. Let's see about cleaning off this corm, tasting that. See if I can get the skin off it easily enough. Oops. There we go. Yeah. Clean enough for me. Just delicious. I mean, you don't need to cook that at all. That's ready to be thrown into a salad or just popped into your mouth. They're really good. Now, these spring beauties grow really, really close to the ground, and the leaves are very tiny. So except when they're in bloom, they're going to be extremely hard for the average identifier to pick out. Someone who really, really can see the differences between these leaves and all the other tiny little leaves on the forest ground might do better than me, but I can only tell them when they're in bloom, so this is the time to be finding them. One other thing I'd like to mention, it's pretty important when you're collecting these, if you're going to be collecting the corms, to exercise restraint in how many you take. If an area doesn't have a lot of the flowers, don't take the corms at all, just leave them, and you can nibble on a few of the plants that are above ground, but leave the corms behind. And if you're in an area that has a lot, like the area we're in right now, make sure you only take a small proportion of the plants you see, so that they can replenish next year. It's just, you want to be able to have the plant again when you come back year after year, and you want other people to be able to enjoy them the same way you can as well. Anyways, that's it for that plant. Let's see what else we can find. All right, we have another one here. This is trout lily. These are also quite easy to identify. Come and have a look. So this is before the flower blooms, and all you see are these mottled, leathery-feeling leaves. Here's a smaller one over here. You can see even when they're small, and there's another even smaller one over here, they're easily identifiable at even these smaller stages. And this is when they're good. This is when they're good to eat. Once they get bigger, once the yellow bell-like, lily-like flower blooms, the flavors are harsher, and they're not worth taking at that point. But at this point, they're really quite good. They're tender and can be eaten in a salad. One more thing I should mention about these. I've been eating these for years, and I have no trouble with them. I can eat a plate full of them and suffer no ill effects, as can my husband. But I have read that some people experience it has an emetic effect on them. It can make them nauseous or purge if they have a large amount. So the first time you eat them, try having only one or two leaves and make sure it doesn't make you feel sick. And the second time you eat them, again, try to have a reasonable portion and see how it makes you feel. And after that, you can probably eat as much as you want. So everywhere I've seen trout lily, they've been plentiful, so I don't think you have to worry too much about taking a few of these for a salad or whatever you want them for. I'm going to dig one up right now so you can see the corm. Got three or four of them right here. Alright, so that's what the plant looks like when it comes up. It has a very small corm at the end. They can be bigger than this, but they don't get huge. And when they come up, they have a yellowish papery sheath that comes off very easily, strips off very easily, and I've already removed it. And now I'm going to eat it. They're delicious. They're sweetish, a little bit acidic, and kind of have a lettucey taste. Really, really good. I love having these in salads. I'm going to dig up a few more.
All right, so this plant is why we've come to this area today. This is wild leeks or ramps, and they're really a jackpot of spring wild edible foraging. They're a wonderful plant, tastes like a cross between a garlic and a leek, but it has a flavor all of its own, and it's delicious eaten even raw. You can throw them in your salads, or you can cook them any way you cook a green onion or a leek or even garlic. Make them with eggs, cook them with any potato dish, cook them with rice, make delicious risotto. You can pickle them, and they're wonderful pickled. They'll last a year that way, and you can dehydrate them if you want to take your results camping with you after all of that. So the plant is rather distinct looking. It's one of the biggest plants up at this time of year. It's got these nice big broad leaves, and it smells, this whole patch just smells like onion. And that's the most important thing for identifying these. There is a plant, and I don't know the name of it, that looks a little bit like this, that is poisonous. So you have to be able to identify this as a wild leek, and the way you do that is you smell it. It smells strongly, strongly, strongly of onions. You can't mistake this for a non-onion plant. If you're not sure that you're not sure if it smells like onion, then it's not an onion. Don't put it in your mouth. You'll know. Of course, still, make sure you get a guide and identify it properly. So I'm going to dig this plant up right now so you can see the bulb. These are at the perfect time right now of year. They're at the right point in their growth to be digging up the bulbs. They're big now. Let's see if I can get one out. I think I've got a rocky spot here. There's one. Perfect. So, it's a small one, but that's what it looks like. Just the skin peels off just like that. You don't need to do anything fancy to it. And you just take off the root end. Like that. Clean it up a bit. And eat it. It's fantastic. It's oniony. You have to like onions. If you don't like onions, don't eat these. But if you do like the taste of onion, it's really, really good. And the younger they are, the milder they taste. As they get older, they get stronger. And as I mentioned before, if you like pickled onions, you really should try pickling these. They're unbelievably good. Now, one thing I should mention is when you pull up the bulbs on these, you are destroying the plant. These plants will propagate, but if you pull up the whole patch, or if you pull up too much of the patch, it can't possibly propagate fast enough. So if you find a patch like this, you never want to take more than 10% of a patch in a year. You want to give it a chance to replenish itself. This is actually a fairly good sized patch, so you could probably take a dozen or even two dozen plants from here, no problem, and then walk away. And if you wanted more, you just go to another patch. There's patches, you know, I mean, they grow everywhere. Another thing I want to mention is don't spread the word about where you find these. People will buy, will come and they'll pick them to sell them. They're very popular vegetable, wild vegetable. And someone who doesn't have the proper sense will come and they'll strip an area in order to make some money, and you'll never be able to find it here again. And although it's not a rare plant in Ontario, in other places they became so popular, like Quebec, that the countryside was being picked bare, and they had to enact laws to prevent people from picking so many. So you can only pick a certain number in Quebec, and there's all kinds of laws governing it, and we don't want that to happen in Ontario. So let's just be mindful of how many we pick when we do collect them. So generally, when we find a patch that we like, we just keep it a secret. We keep it to ourselves. We don't even want to tell too many people that we know, because if we tell a person and they tell a person, then the next thing you know, again, the patch is devastated. If someone wants to find ramps, they'll be able to find them themselves. I don't know if I mentioned this, the whole plant's edible, not just the bulb. The leaf is actually just as good as the bulb. It's oniony, but it's just a delicious leaf, and just throw it on a salad if you like onion. Really good. Okay, so I'm just going to pick a few more of these, and then we're going to make a salad with all the vegetables we've collected today. See you soon. All right, so with just a little bit of effort, we've collected enough food for a decent-sized salad. So let me show you what we have here. Here we have the trout lilies and a few of their corms. I didn't collect too many of the corms because so much of the biomass is in the leaves, and I just didn't want to put forth the effort to collect these little tiny corms. Even though they're edible, they're kind of work to get out. I have a few of the ramp leaves, the wild leek leaves. I didn't want too many of these for a salad because they'll overpower the taste of the rest, so I'm just going to use a few of them. Over here we have the stems, leaves, and flowers of the spring beauty, and they're going to be wonderful. And here I have the corms of the spring beauty. Now I've prepared a couple of them differently so you can see. This is completely skinned. I've taken the skin right off it, and it just turns into this white skin potato looking thing. And here it is with the skin on. A lot less work to prepare. You just clean it up in some spring water and it's good to eat. So the choice is yours how you want to prepare them. It's a matter of presentation. And I always take, when I go camping, a Nalgene container full of salad dressing so that when I find spring edibles, I can make a salad and have fresh food, fresh greens with my meals. A salad that, like the one we're going to prepare today, is a great accompaniment to any dehydrated meal that you can have in the bush. And if you catch fish, it's a wonderful side for fish. This will never leak. These Nalgene containers work amazingly with oil, and you don't have to worry about it. You can just throw them in your pack and not worry about oil leaking at all. So I'm preparing this as a salad because it's easy, and that's what I want today. But all of these vegetables can be sautéed as well. If you want a cooked green dish, these green leeks are amazing cooked. If you can cook them up with some potatoes or something like potatoes, like these corms, that would be a wonderful sauté. The trout lilies can also be sautéed lightly. I don't know if I would sauté these. I never have before. They're too much like sprouts to me, and I imagine they've just got to be much better fresh. So I've never even tried sautéing them, but you can. And you can use your imagination to cook these things up any way you like. But those are the two ways I traditionally make them, either as a stir fry on the side of a meal or as a salad on the side of a meal. The ramps are the only thing that I've cooked with many other kinds of foods, and I've already described that. So let's make a salad.
So this is the finished salad, all put together and dressed in vinaigrette. And I'm dying to taste this. Oh, that's good. A camping trip, this can't be beat. So, we hope that you get a sense of what this is like. This isn't survival food. This is actually delicious food. You could serve this in a restaurant and people would enjoy it. It's that tasty and it's nutritious. No preservatives, no additives, just nature's fresh bounty. And when you're on a camping trip, you always bring your own camping food, your dehydrated meals, or your store-bought freeze-dried meals, that sort of thing. After a while in the bush, it's really nice to have fresh greens and vegetables and fruit. And foraging and harvesting wild edibles is really the only way to do that. They just won't last long enough for a camping trip. So just take advantage of this. Go out in early spring. That's the take-home message from this. Go out in early spring. Identify a few plants as they're sprouting. It's the best time to spot these particular specimens. And slowly you'll learn to identify more plants. And when you're on a camping trip, it's a really nice, satisfying feeling. Never mind all the survivalist stuff, and survival food. It's really nice to have a good, fresh plate of food on a camping trip. It turns you from a tourist to someone who's actually living in the bush, and that's deeply satisfying. And just the harvesting of them is really zen-like. You know, it took about an hour or more to harvest this, enough food for two people, and time went by like that, and it felt fantastic. It'll really enhance your camping. All right.